On today's show,
which game was wilder, the Raptors' huge fourth quarter comeback or the Hawks' dominating home win?
In Crossfire, is Curry or CP3 the bigger loss? And should Dwight head to Dallas?
And Jason Terry guarantees a Rockets win in Oakland tonight. Does anybody believe him?
It's Wednesday, April 27th. The starter starts, pow! Oh.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us live on NBA TV or a little bit later on YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Millis.
This isn't the Kawhi Claw today. It's the Raptor Claw.
To his right, it's the international man of mystery taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lily, and last, certainly not least, over there, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
Trey, what do you have for us tonight?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at #TheStarters. And yesterday, the Sacramento Kings unveiled their new logo with a pretty sweet little futuristic sort of retro look. I really like it. More importantly, however, the Kings are offering free tattoos to any fans that want these logos tattooed on their body. They're at 5 different tattoo parlors in Sacramento today. All they're asking in return is that you tweet a picture of your tattoo with #NewEraOfProud along with a picture, and that's it. People are taking them up on the offer, lining up overnight, and then following through with an array of various tattoos, some better than the other. Nonetheless, we thought this was pretty cool because unbeknownst to most people, the four of us actually have NBA tattoos. You just can't usually see them. You've seen some of my tattoos. But people don't know I have a giant bowl across my brownies. Got it when they were trying to make the playoffs earlier this year. Didn't work out. Tass and Skeets, obviously, Raptors fans. They got inked up before we left Toronto. Tass, he loves claws. Got the ball claw. Skeets went with the classic 90s dinosaur on his chest, keeping the city close to his heart. As for Lee, well, people know he already has my face tattooed on his leg. And while he doesn't have a favorite team, he did get his favorite NBA thing tattooed right on his back. That's Manu Ginobili making a bounce pass right there on the lower part of his back. Very sexy, but it brings us to today's question. If you were getting an NBA tattoo, what would you get and why? Tweet it to us at #TheStarters, and we'll critique them a little bit later.
All right, get those tweets in. Yeah, you always pose very sexy when you show your tattoos.
Well, you gotta bring it, you know? When Trey says to bring it, I bring it.
All right, okay, we got Crossfire Tass tonight. We'll go head-to-head in that, and we'll get you set for tonight's 3 games in the playoffs. But first, we're gonna play a little What You Got. If you're new to the show, it's pretty simple. Trey presents us with 2 related topics. We have to determine the better choice. And the catch is there's only one right answer, and that is whatever it is according to TK himself. So Trey, what you got, playoff edition, first one.
Yeah, our first topic, we had an exciting night of Eastern Conference basketball yesterday as the Raptors were always on the move, always on the run during a thrilling comeback from 17 down to take a 3-2 series lead against the Pacers. Nice try, Solomon Hill. Not to be outdone, the Hawks rubbed the hot hands of Kent Bazemore and the regional manager Mike Scott, obviously, to a 27-point victory against the Celtics, taking a 3-2 lead in their series. What was the wilder game, the Raps' comeback or the Hawks' dominance? What you got?
Are you kidding?
Yeah, come on.
Of course it's the Raps. You mentioned it, down 17 in the first half. They allowed 61 points in the first half in a pivotal Game 5 where it looked like the only time they could score and make up some of that ground was when Paul George went to the bench. So in the fourth, when Paul George was sitting and they were down 13 going into the fourth quarter, I didn't have hope that they would win, but I thought they'd bring it in within single digits, and that did happen within 7 when Paul George came back. And then home court advantage took over. If this game was on the road, there's no chance that they're winning this game. Home court advantage took over when this man decided to throw it down. Norman Powell, a huge dunk. He actually said after the game that he almost lost that ball.
He almost did.
Which would have been a little crazy, but it tied that game. And Paul George looked human in the last few minutes, you know, having to guard DeMar DeRozan the entire game, putting in 39 points, and they still lost. That was astonishing.
And Paul George didn't get some touches on some of those possessions as well, where I felt the Pacers really had to go to him because he managed the game so well. He was in control, one of his best performances. There was no indication, though, this was coming from the Raptors. They were playing pretty badly, and towards the end of that third quarter, you felt that the Pacers were just pulling away. And you can understand why Frank Vogel sat Paul George to start the fourth quarter, because he felt that that second unit could have at least kept the lead somewhat safe, but that didn't happen.
That's what's nuts about it. This is why it's wilder. Not only did they give up a 13-point lead that they had going into the fourth quarter, it was gone when Powell throws down that dunk in about 5.5 minutes. That's what the insane part was. They go on to win the game, which was huge too. Oh, by the way, it's wild too because Solomon Hill hits the three, and I have to admit, I thought it was good. In live, I was like, that's in. Maybe it's just because I'm a pessimistic Raptors fan and everything seems to go wrong for them. I thought it was good. Of course, they look at it, and it is as close as humanly possible to just being on Solomon Hill's fingertips before he got it off, before the buzzer goes off. It has to be this Raptors game.
Yeah, and that second unit for the Pacers has not been good all season. Zach Lowe's written about it. It wasn't good in the first half. If you wanted to seal the deal, I know it's easy to look back right now, but Paul George only played 41 minutes in this game. He should have been out there a little bit sooner. He came back with 8.5 minutes left, and it was down to 7. And he said before the game, what we have to do is shut this home court up. And they let them back in the game. And home court just pulled them across the line at the end.
The Hawks game was fun to watch, but it was dominance pretty much from that third quarter onwards. They were down 10 early in the first quarter, and then Kyle Korver and everyone just turned it on. But it's always more fun when you're the home team and you're behind and you come back and have a huge win. The Raptors did that. The Hawks, on the other hand, really just sort of pulled away from Boston, who didn't really look too good after the games 3 and 4.
I can't pick the Hawks game because the Hawks, all season long, it feels like, go from one quarter looking like one of the best teams in the league to the next quarter looking like one of the worst. They are so Jekyll and Hyde, this team. Last night they were unbelievable and just punked the Celtics. The big thing from that was Isaiah Thomas getting hurt in about a 30-point game late in that one. Tweaks his ankle. He says he's good to go for game 6 back in Boston. Thankfully for that, we've had enough injuries, I believe, in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. But definitely the Raptors game.
They're pretty good at being Jekyll and Hyde as well, though.
The Celtics.
No, the Raps.
Well, yeah, that's true. Trey, what's the answer?
Oh, come on, guys. It's the Raptors. Yeah. No doubt about it. A comeback, always more exciting than a blowout. Plus, we had that huge Norman Powell dunk. Exciting stuff. And speaking of the Raptors game, Drake was draking hard last night as the Raptors' global ambassador used his courtside view in the six to get in Rodney Stuckey's ear following a late turnover. Then later, Drake used his Instagram to zing Paul George, dropping a tear emoji on the Pacers star and calling him scared before deleting the post. What was the worst Drake decision? The annoying claps or the Instagram diss?
I can't.
What you got?
I can't imagine we're going to disagree on this one. It's the Instagram post.
Yeah, that's weak sauce.
By far the worst Drake decision. If a guy's clapping and he's sitting courtside, it means he's into the game. That's cool. I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
He didn't touch him. He's right there. He wants to be an annoying fan. That's home court advantage, as you talked about, Seth. This post, which he then takes down.
Oh, which works all the time.
Which is, that makes it even worse. If you're going to blast this gram, leave that gram. Let that gram breathe. Don't take it down immediately. Yeah. And what are you doing? I mean, Paul George, 39-8-8.
He made the right play at the end, too. He got doubled and he found the open man who hit the shot. Like, that was the right basketball play. Frank Vogel even said afterwards. So.
Yeah, I don't think Paul George was scared.
No.
Shoot a potential game-tying three. He made the right play.
Oh, no, he was spectacular, and that's why you can't put him on an Instagram post. And second of all, you put up an old photo of him as an Instagram post. You were at a live sporting event. It's called Instagram. You don't just throw up an old photo. That's why I don't like it, number one. Number two, he was in Rodney Stuckey's face, as you mentioned. Does he do that to Paul George? I don't think so.
Probably not.
I think only in Rodney. So they're both poor choices, in my opinion. I love Drake's enthusiasm. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
I got no problem with that. We saw him do it with Justin Holiday earlier in the year, doing something similar. That's fine. That's being called being a fan.
Maybe he's a big 50 Cent fan. Who knows? Just clapping.
Because Rodney Stuckey looks like
50 Cent. He does. A rap reference.
Yeah, we're definitely going to go with the Instagram post.
Yeah, it's the Instagram diss. Paul George was legitimately killing last night.
Oh.
It wasn't his fault. Drake, nonetheless, after what some are calling the worst night in Clippers history, the team announced yesterday that Blake Griffin will be out for the remainder of the playoffs with a left quad injury, and that following hand surgery, Chris Paul would be out indefinitely, though recovery time is 4 to 6 weeks. If the Clippers decide to blow their team up, what would be the smarter trade? Blake Griffin or Chris Paul? What you got?
Whoa, if they were to blow it up between Chris Paul and Blake Griffin, I gotta keep the younger guy. I think that's the biggest factor.
Really?
Chris Paul is 31 in a couple weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Plays at a position that could be filled by someone by the name of Russell Westbrook when he comes off his contract next season in 2017. Hey, he's from LA. Maybe the Lakers situation doesn't work out. They're both all-world talents. I really don't think they're trading either of them this offseason. I think Doc Rivers used that end-of-the-window sort of analogy that we're coming to the edge of it just to get his guys riled up. So he's the guy who makes the personnel moves. I don't think he wants to
trade
either one.
But if you have to go with one, you go Chris Paul.
I'm going to go with Chris Paul. You're going to talk about injuries. Chris Paul has the injuries as well.
Yeah, Chris Paul is a better all-round player at both ends of the floor, but I actually think Blake probably has a little bit more trade value just because he is younger.
Yeah. Blake's trade value would be at an all-time low for him right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, but I think teams will still be happy to have him on their team. He's only 27. I think he's still an elite power forward. He's had an awful season. It's been terrible, there's no doubt. But remember, was it last season he was third in MVP voting? So it
was the first half of his season was pretty good this year.
Yeah, when he plays and when he's healthy, and like we saw in the playoffs last year, I mean, he's easily one of the best in the league. And again, at 27, I'm sure there's plenty of GMs out there who'd be happy to have him.
Blake has a year left on his contract before he could opt out and look at free agency. I actually disagree with you guys. I think if you had to, in the hypothetical, because I'm sort of with you, Tass, I don't think they actually do. But if they did, I think they would look to move Blake. Yes, the value is at an all-time low with him. You're still going to get a nice package back. And Chris Paul, he's in, because of his age, win now, win now, win now. He still is an elite point guard. Yeah, the injuries are there, but he is still an elite point guard.
Yeah.
I don't know if we can say that because of Blake's last year or so, if he's still going to get back to that level that we saw in 2014. That's the worrying question to me about Blake. So if you had to trade one, it'd be Blake. But what's the answer to this, TK? It's only up to you.
You got
to
trade Chris Paul. Blake's younger, he's cheaper, and he's way more fun. Make the Clippers fun again is what I say.
He's lost that explosiveness, man.
Oh,
tell that to the Plumlee brothers.
I don't know. All right, got to take a break. When we come back, debates continue. Tass and I step into the crossfire to debate whether Dwight Howard would be a good fit in Dallas. Come back.
Crossfire, this is how it works. Trey will give Skeets and me three topics. We will debate each one, and you at home will declare the winner on Twitter. Trey, let's tell them how it works.
Yeah, if you're tweeting along at home and you think Tass is winning, blast a tweet that says hashtag Tass wins. If you think Skeets is winning, that's hashtag Skeets wins. Every tweet counts, so tweet early, tweet often, and here we go, round one. We had a couple of postseason bummers this week, as on back-to-back nights, we lost Stephen Curry to a knee injury and Chris Paul to a broken hand. Who's the bigger loss, Steph Curry or Chris Paul? Here we go.
It's definitely Chris Paul. Chris Paul is everything to his team.
He's key.
The best defender, the best playmaker, the absolute leader on that team. You can't say the same for Steph. He just has more talent around him who do other things. And plus, with Blake Griffin out, Chris Paul had to do even more. He's a ton at both ends. He's the voice in the locker room. The best everything on his team. I don't see how they miss him less than they'd miss Steph on Golden State.
Because here's the thing. No one truthfully thought the Clippers were going to win a title this year.
Well,
they didn't.
What does it matter?
Even if Chris Paul is healthy, even if Blake Griffin is healthy, this is a three-team race. It's the Spurs, it's the Warriors, and it's maybe the Cavs coming out of these. That's it. It's the truth. So the potential to me, the bigger or the more bigger loss, worse loss, if you want to call it that, is Curry. Possibly. He's coming back, hopefully, in the second round. But we don't know what he's going to look like. And if he's not the MVP like Curry, then yeah, they got a great team there. But I don't think you bank on them winning a title without Curry up to the 100% Curry that we know. That's why it could be, potentially be a bigger loss, in my opinion.
People dismissing the Clippers and Thunder.
Oh, come on. I didn't say that.
Well, round two, here we go. According to Chandler Parsons, Dwight Howard is going to leave Houston this summer, and his bro Chan Chan can't wait to recruit him to the Mavs. Would Dwight be a good fit in Dallas? Here we go.
For $25 million or whatever it's going to cost, no.
Oh, Cuban's
absolutely
got the bucks?
Not. Cuban's got the buck. That would be ridiculous.
What?
Dwight Howard is not worth $25+ million. He used to be a great basketball player. He might be a good basketball player now, but he ain't worth max money, Taz. And that's what Chandler Parsons said. He says he thinks Dwight can still dominate the game. Not consistently he can't. And he hasn't over the last 3 years. He's gotten worse and worse and worse. I don't actually think he is a good fit.
Dwight is a great basketball player. He will fit anywhere. He will fit anywhere on any team at any time. Listen, he is not
he
6 years
Kobe
ago,
that
Dwight.
Well,
Kobe, okay. I mean, yeah, it didn't work out. Yeah, he's not 20-12, Dwight, but he's 14-12 this year. He had the least amount of shots since his rookie year. He shot 62%. Give him a couple more shots, like he should have, because he shoots 62%, and he's 18-12. Call him a crybaby or whatever. He was in a bad situation. That situation made Trevor Ariza a bad defender and Patrick Beverley a bad defender. Dwight Howard's a good basketball player.
Is he in a bad situation, or does the bad situation, that bad cloud,
well,
follow him?
He was still good, 62%.
LA and the Rockets, he's gotten worse and worse.
He missed 11 games.
$25 million?
Yeah, in this day and age, that's nothing.
Oh, really makes you think, but round three coming around here. And Jason Terry guaranteed those Rockets would win game 5 against the Warriors tonight, saying, I believe in my group. I know we can get a win here and send this thing back to Houston.
Love that confidence.
Guys, make a bold playoff prediction. Here we go!
All right, Chris Bosch is coming back in the second round. I've got nothing to go on.
I like it.
I'm just reaching with this one.
Yeah.
That being said, Chris Bosch is traveling with the team. He's laughing with the team. He's hanging out with the team. He's actually in practices shooting around. And I'd love to see him in round two against the Toronto Raptors. Bold prediction. They're winning their first round series. It'd be a nice little comeback. And his wife, Adrienne Bosch, actually put up a hashtag on Instagram, hashtag bring back Bosch, because they want to play.
Yeah.
They want him back.
Great situation.
But Miami is saying, nah, you might want to hang out for a bit. I think he'll be back.
I hope he is, actually. I like that prediction. I will say, my real bold prediction, Raps will not only win the first round, they'll win a second round.
Excuse me?
Hold on, I'm not done. They'll win the title. No, my real prediction, it ain't that. It is Russell Westbrook, at one point in this second round against the Spurs, is gonna dunk on Boban Marjanovic. Russell Westbrook is going to give us the dunk of the playoffs. He's dunking on the 7'3" Serbian. Book it.
Dunking on Tass Mellis, because J.E. Skeets is the winner.
Dunk on you, big guy. Boom. We gotta take a break. When we return, is it bye 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 for the Rockets tonight in Oakland? Jason Terry says it's not. Does he know something we don't? Come on back, you're watching The Starters. Back with The Starters and that sexy lower tattoo on the back of Lili. We asked you, what NBA tattoo would you get and why? Would you get a Ginobili tattoo? Like Lee, you let us know on Twitter, hashtag Starters. Trey, you got a few of the best answers.
Yeah, Nick says, Sam Hinkie, might as well if there's a billboard. Bad advice to follow, getting tattoos of every billboard you see, but whatever. Jay says, both teams played hard, my man, on the chest. And good bless and good night on the back. Shout out to Rasheed Wallace. But the best answer comes from Quinn, who says, I'd get a Chris Anderson tattoo for maximum tattooception.
Oh, yeah.
There'd be a lot of tattoos on your tattoo.
That's a good point. All right. Keep the tweets coming, guys. All right. Let's look at tonight's NBA schedule. We got three games going tonight. TNT doubleheader. It's the Hornets in Heat. Game five. That series tied at 2 apiece. Game five in Miami. And later tonight, Rockets and Warriors. Warriors lead that one 3-1. Jason Terry says they're going to extend it. We'll find out. That's the late game. And on NBA TV, 10 o'clock start tonight, Blazers and Clippers. That series also tied at 2 apiece in LA. No Chris Paul and no Blake. And let's start with that series and a little true or false here. I'm going to ask you here, Tass. True or false, can the Clippers win this game, this series, whatever you want to call it, without Chris Paul and without Blake Griffin?
I do not think that they win this series. I worry about this team without those guys who draw double teams out there playing one-on-one. Let's start with Blake Griffin's replacement, Jeff Green. He hasn't been very good when he's been in the starting lineup this season. His numbers actually get worse when he goes from the bench to the starting lineup. You wouldn't think so, even though his minutes go up, efficiency down, just plays worse, period. He's going to be out there without a Blake, without a Chris Paul, drawing guys away from him, having that gravity on offense. I'm very worried about Jeff Green on offense. Basically, I think you're just going to have guys take over. A Jamal Crawford comes out there and goes for 25, 26. It's possible.
Austin Rivers has been known to have big games before.
But they're just so used to playing with these talented guys that draw away guys. I don't see them winning 2 out of 3. Yeah, maybe they can rally around a home court for one win. I just don't see them winning enough.
Yeah, you can see them sort of tonight inside fighting for every possession and every basket. But overall, the talent now between them and Portland is just so deep. And I think the Blazers, I mean, Lillard, like we said, he's only had one really good game in this series. He's due to have a really big one, especially not having Chris Paul defending him.
Yeah, and they've gotten better as the series have gone on. And the Blazers will be happy not to see Chris Paul or Blake Griffin out there, because they're just going to guard everybody one-on-one, right?
And
they'll be comfortable.
I also would not be shocked if, once they get into bonus at least, if Terry Sotts says, hack a DeAndre, get him to the line, put him in the line, to try and force Doc's hand to even get him out of the game.
Yeah.
You know, their other best player, once they get into the bonus, of course, not to waste fouls otherwise.
Yeah,
I would not be shocked by that at all, but you're right. Austin Rivers or Jamal Crawford or Jeff Green, who's can show
it's
up every once in a while.
Great opportunity, though, for someone like Jeff.
One of those guys has to be huge tonight. Yeah. They're going to probably have a starting lineup with, you know, Austin Rivers, J.J. Redick, Luke Bamute, Jeff Green, and DeAndre Jordan that has never played a single minute this regular season together. That is the likely starting lineup. So you never know what's going to happen with a lineup you've never
tried before. Maybe beginner's luck. You never know.
Yeah, that's possible. It's possible. All right, let's move on to the other series, the latest game tonight. That is the Warriors and Rockets. It's in Oakland. No Steph Curry. Everyone knows that. Jason Terry says, hey, we're going to get this win. He guaranteed it. We just talked about it in Crossfire. True or false, though, Lee, even without Curry, the Warriors send the Rockets fishing tonight?
True. But I'll say this. No team down 3-1 has ever looked like coming back. Every time there's a 3-1 deficit, you think they're gone. And last year we saw that with the Rockets against the Clippers.
Nearly knocked your water over there. Yeah. But listen, it's that giant cup you had.
Shout out to Rolando. Listen, JB Bickerstaff and coaches, they never want their players on social media getting
nice.
Distracted.
Very
but if,
nice.
But if I was him, I would be saying, read Twitter, read Facebook, get on Instagram. Everyone thinks we have no chance in this series. And the Rockets have deserved that ridicule because they've been bad.
Right.
The effort hasn't been there. But you've got an opportunity tonight to at least say to the doubters, listen, we're going to at least go down fighting. Don't get blown out by 40 when the best player, the MVP, is not even on that team. You have some minor hope of pulling off a miracle, but it has to start with effort and energy. And it's got to start with guys like James Harden and Dwight Howard. They're two leaders. So they're going to go home. They're going to lose. but if you are JB,
you just want to see a fight.
I want to see some effort from them. But yeah. Also, I mean, you never see something like this coming before it happens. So
do you think the fact that they came back last year from a 3-1 deficit on the Clippers helps or hurts them?
Well, of course it helps because they can believe in themselves.
I
mean,
they
know
did
it's
it.
Possible.
And yeah. Remember how bad they looked against the Clippers in those first four games. They looked awful. And Chris Paul was out for the first two, remember, and they lost one at home. So somehow they did it last year. This is a completely different situation because the Warriors are a better team than the Clippers were. But I
think they had a miracle last year, and I don't even know if they believe it. They
look at scored 41-20 in the third quarter of their last game with Steph Curry not out there.
I know.
Now they're going to turn it on?
Well,
like, hey, man, this is it. They're going to come out. They're going to give effort. But not really.
They haven't convinced anyone that they've got that effort. But, you know, like I say, you've got some at least fire to fire up those players and say, don't embarrass yourself tonight.
Yeah. No, the bulletin board material is definitely there for the Rockets. Tonight.
Stay off Instagram, 20-year-olds.
Right. One more break. Let me come back. Lee's. ESP. Back to the starters, time for Lee's very solid play. We're going to Toronto or Atlanta, man?
We're going to the Fortress. Todd, the cameraman, was down there last night, and he said the Fortress was rocking, and when Coach Kyle wasn't raining bombs, he was making beautiful passes and layups like this. Beautiful stuff here. You can't just protect him on the perimeter. You got to watch inside. You should dunk that, though, Carl. That's what I call a very solid play.
Back to the fundamentals. Mm.
Don't dunk it. I love layups.
I was going to say, I thought you were against dunking. I can't figure it out. Again, quick look at tonight's schedule. Three games. TNT is Hornets Heat at 8 p.m., followed by the Rockets and Warriors. Blazers Clips sandwich in between them. 10 p.m. start here on the network on NBA TV. We're back tomorrow at 6:30 p.m. Eastern to talk about all the big games and all the big storylines.
Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, getting your blood going before a competition or a meeting guarantees victory.
Brace the night, people. Wow!